But guys, gonna try to teach you something about how the infantry takes on tanks. And we're gonna begin with something very stupid but very simple. This one. In World War I, when tanks were a new concept, there wasn't something that they had against it, so they had the development. And they went from normal bullets wouldn't penetrate the tank. So easiest things for them, the simplest thing for them to do was to increase the broad. So you all know the famous German Panzergewehr, or like the for the British, the boys' rifle that they used in the beginning of World War II. And this one, actually, the armor evolves. So this one evolves. And this one, for instance, this is an armor-piercing shot from a 6-pounder, or for the Americans, 57mm. Basically still the same idea as this one, just a piece of metal that enters a tank and hopefully do some damage. These, in the beginning of World War II, they worked, but later on they didn't. Something we see coming in the field halfway through World War II are these two things. This is a later one, a big one, but like the Panzerfaust and the bazooka. This is actually from a round from a super bazooka. But those two things came to the infantry for taking on tanks. And how work these things? They use two principles: a hollow charge and a shaped charge. Correction, hollow charge and explosive form penetrator, to be correct. People are gonna say, but it's completely the same. No, it isn't. But let me explain why. I'm gonna use the Panzerfaust for it. If you see here, here's a line. Here as well. Behind here is a cone made of explosive. Here and here, they have just air, there's nothing in between. And what that does is when the round, the rocket, hits a target, it gets, the detonator goes off. We'll explain later the possible detonators that they have, but keep it simple for now. It makes an explosive here explode. And because of the shape of the explosive is in the cone, and the distance here, it forces all its energy at one point. That's the hollow charge. This one exactly the same. Now you're gonna say, well, yes, but it has a copper lining. Correct. That's that they have found out that you can increase the effect if you put in a copper liner. So basically, explosive form penetrator. So in here, to enhance it, there's a copper lining, here as well. What that does, it uses the advantages of the hollow charge and changes in a red and a very hot needle that punches through the tank. A hollow charge, this distance has only, its force is only limited to a certain area. So if it explodes too far from the armor, it loses its effect. The copper lining inside prevents that. So that's why they combine the two elements. Sounds strange, but that's what it is. And here they use it exactly the same. This one is from the Super Bazooka. This one is from after the war. We all know the bazookas, that concept that died, so they don't use it anymore. This one evolved actually in, well, we all know it, the Lau, the M72 Lau, and for the Russians, the RPG-7. In the beginning they started with an RPG-2, 3, those were basically improved versions of this one where you could use a tube multiple times, but only a couple of times. With RPG 2 and RPG 3, you would use it multiple times. With the RPG 7, you can keep going on with that. This one, the M72. It's a good weapon from when it came out, but it has its limited use. One, also the problem that these two had, they are rockets. And when they fire, you have no control over them. But how do you adjust, how they fix that, I'm gonna hold that for later. Now, I said something about how they set these explosives off. There are basically two methods of doing. The oldest system, there was like a flamethrower. I don't know if flamethrower is the correct word, but there was a little detonator in the front here. And there was like a tube that go in the center of this, through the explosive in the back. Here it would be then, could be a booster, or that sets on the main charge, and that sets off, and that makes sure that the explosive charge goes off. So, the more modern one, and you can very clearly see on the RPG 7 round, there's a little circular tube on it. That's, we call it a piezo element. Don't know the exact English word for it, but that's actually a little crystal. When you squeeze it, then it gives an electric impulse. That electric impulse goes to the detonator in the back instead of the main charge. So those are the two methods used for setting these off. Now, back to World War II. Gonna make some room. Infantry had something else. This very simple wooden box is able to stop a mine. If lucky, to kill it. But that depends on how big the explosive charge is in it. And this one, just a plain wooden box that they fill with explosive. There are metal ones. There are even made of, there are even landmines just made out of explosive, that the outside is the explosive. And how this one works, we call it landmine anti-tank for mobility kill. So this from a German mine, this is from a Teller mine. That's a detonator and it works on pressure. So the tank has actually to drive over it to let it go off. So if the tanks go left or right, with the strike left or right of it, it won't do shit. Now, there are methods to prevent that. Bring on this one. This from during the Cold War. But what it is, they screw this detonator in the mine. When the tank or another vehicle drives over it with its belly, it pushes this rod. It breaks something inside, an explosive charge will go off. Now, usually those mines are combined with an explosive form penetrator. Not the one like these, but it's basically just a copper ball it's much thicker than this one. This is just maybe a millimeter or something, maybe less, but actually a centimeter or something, so depends on the mine. And when it explodes, it turns inside out and forms a copper fist that punches through the hole of the tank. For instance, that drawing, this is a Yugoslavian mine, TMRP 6, and the red thing here, That's actually the copper dish. When the yellow, that's explosive, goes off, it pushes this inside out and becomes a metal fist. Not a needle like this one, but actually a metal fist that punches through. And normally here, this one would have, this one has now a detonator on pressure on it, but there are detonators with a long tilt rod, so they come something, the tilt rod is something like this big, so when the tank drives over this belly, it goes off. There are other systems to make those mines go off under the belly, like for instance magnetic induction, when enough metal disturbs the magnetic field that the mine creates, it also goes off. So, landmines, very useful. Now, back to the rockets, or the evolution of the rockets. I'm gonna talk first about this one, its predecessor. This is the 84 Spirit in its NATO name, or the Faggot in its Russian name. The predecessor of this one is the 83 Sire. It was still a rocket but guided, and they first used it in large scale in the Yom Kippur War between Israel and Egypt. When Egypt crossed the Suez Canal, they distributed a lot of 83 Sires to their infantry and Israelis. From previous experience, they found out if we send in our tanks, the infantry usually buggers off. And they found out they didn't. And suddenly, they figured out that tanks were exploding, were being killed, but there weren't any other tanks in the area. That was the work for the 83 Sire. It was just a missile, but it was able to be guided onto target. So like these two, this one I already called, but this one, Milan, do exactly the same more and bigger versions. Now, how do they guide them to the target? With this you can actually see it still. When it comes out, there's still a little cable attached to it. So, the missile flies out, and the shooter still has to aim at the target, but through the wire, the missile knows they have to adjust. This one exactly the same. However, there are some other systems in the past that they used. They used wire, laser, infrared, all this kind. Small disadvantages that this one has, these two has, but the great advantages of these two is that they have a much longer range than this one. But this one, that one goes up 200 meters, I would say. And I've seen people struggling with hitting something at 100 meters, so, but still, this one will go to 4 kilometers. This one, I don't know exactly, but probably some people will tell me in the comments. But the big disadvantage that these two has, the shooter has still keep an eye on the target. With the later ones, like the chill or the spike, they have something that they call fire and forget. So the shooter locks the target, shoots the missile, and the missile does it, and it doesn't have to control the missile anymore. So that's the future. That's the present now, actually. So, hope it was informative. Let me know and make more of these things.